بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أضحب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد واللانة دامة الباقي لأعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها الله سبحانه وتعالى in Surah Baqarah ayat number 286 makes a very clear statement لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها that Allah سبحانه وتعالى does not impose upon anyone more than the ability that they have as far as their obligations and the duties are concerned. Keeping this overall theme of Allah's benevolence and mercy, I would like to, address a question, although tonight is a question answer session, but I also wanted to dedicate this majlis on a question that I have received for more than one individual in the last few months, actually, even a year before, about some of the rituals which are done for the Chalisma or the 48th of the Marhumeen, which is becoming lately common among the women in our community. And before I come to this list of rituals that I've been given, one version of it, that these are the things that they do, at the home or wherever they gather for the 40th day of the deceased. Let me first of all, give you the list of what is considered to be the authentic rituals based on the teachings of the Prophet and the Aimma of Ahlul Bayt, alayhim salatu wasalam. And to understand this these rules about mourning and ta'ziyah, how to relate to this issue of death and what happens after that. I'm just giving you a brief summary of the guidelines given in the famous book of fiqh, Al-Urwatul Wuthqa, which is commonly accepted by our maraji. Most of the maraji, actually, when they write their books on, manual of Islamic edicts and rulings, they follow the pattern of Al-Urwatul Wuthqa. Number one, for example, paying condolence to the grieving person or family before and after the burial is highly recommended. It is considered to be an important thing as far as, how do we relate to the family of the deceased. And just the presence of yourself in the funeral ceremony or in the burial ceremony is sufficient. Even if you don't talk to them, if they see you, you are there, that is considered to be the minimum, fulfillment of this duty of ta'ziyah, which means paying condolence to the grieving, family. And then second important thing, part of our religious rituals, is that sending food to the grieving family for 3 days. Of course, this will apply more to the relatives first, or the neighbors. And if there's nobody around, then the rest of the community. And this is a strong recommendation based on the Sunnah of Rasulullah, where we hear from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, alayhi salatu wasalam, where he says that when Ja'far bin Abi Talib, Ja'far al-Tayyar, the cousin of Rasulullah, the brother of Ali, when he was killed in the Battle of Tabuk, أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم فاطمة عليه السلام أن تتخذ طعاما لأسماء بنت عميس وتأتيها. The Prophet of Islam ordered Fatima salawatullah alayha to take food to the house of Asma bint Umayj, the wife of Ja'far bin Abi Talib. And this is where we see this example. Fajjarat bidhalika sunnah, and this is how it became a tradition, because the Prophet said, and yusna'a li ahli al-mayyit ta'amun thalatha ayyam, that for the grieving family, food should be sent for the 3 days. And so this became the sunnah, a highly recommended, you know, act from the Islamic point of view. Then, of course, we have this reciting of two rakat salat. And I leave this issue of controversy between namaz-e wahshat or namaz-e hadiye mayyit. Hadiye mayyit is also one way of, you know, expressing, fulfilling your right towards the marhum. And of course, then we have, when we talk about the issues of mourning and ta'ziyah, you know, emphasize on visiting the graves of the mu'mineen. This is even after their burial. For example, when you go there, you're at the cemetery, right in the beginning, you recite a general salam to all the mu'mineen and mu'minat who are buried there. In our graveyard here in North York, as well as in Al-Hussein Center, Wadi Salam, you will see there is actually a big writing, which is the ziyarat for the Ahl al-Qubur. And then when you go to the grave, you know, the things which are recommended is that, you know, you recite Alhamd three times, Surah Nas three times, Surah Falaq three times, Surah Qadr seven times, or even reciting Surah Yasin is part of the religious, you know, tradition. Then we come to the 40th day of the Marhumeen. Now, this is where we have to realize that this is a tradition which have evolved following the tradition of the azah of Sayyid al-Shuhada Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam. We do the Arba'een, the Chehlum of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And so when our Marhumeen die, we also have this tradition, you know, taking this example from the azah of Sayyid al-Shuhada, that we also have a majlis on the 40th day or around it. It doesn't have to be exactly on the 40th day. Even if you choose a weekend before or after it, there shouldn't be a problem at all. And normally we have a normal, you know, majlis with tabarruk. You know, everyone can do according to their own means. They don't have to feel obliged and overburdened. Now, the reason why I'm talking about these rituals, that the alternative, you know, list that I've seen, and I would like to talk about this very clearly here. So let's hear salawat, please, first. Now, let us look at this other tradition which is gradually becoming common among the women in our community. And even in other cities, I've heard about it. You know, the list that I saw is actually written in Urdu. And I'm sure there is a Gujarati version of it and even the English translation of it. And basically, it says that, for example, on the Chehlum day of the Marhum or the Marhuma, there are special a'mal, rituals that you have to do. And on the, and basically, you know, when you look at the 40th day after the demise of the marhum or the marhuma, for example, in the list it says, recite Dua-i Kumail one time, Dua-i Mashlul one time, Dua-i Adila one time, Dua-i Tawbah one time, Hadith-i Kisa one time, Tasbihati Arba 41 time, Astaghfirullah 41 time, Ayat Karima 41 time, Amma Yujib Al-Bustar, the other ayat, 41 time, and Salawat 41 time, and Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim 41 times. Now, I'm told that there is another list which is even longer than that, the number of surahs that they have to recite. And so it's becoming common now that, you know, The surahs are divided among the ladies. Everybody takes up one surah to recite for the marhum for that day, especially the 40th day. Now, let me make it clear. We have to understand whatever we do. Alhamdulillah, we have quite a lot in our resources from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the imams of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is where we have to see, you know, are these things coming from the ma'sumeen or not? Or are these just, you know, things people have made up? None of these items are anything wrong by themselves, no. But for example, look at the list. Dua Kumail. If you look at the narration, you will see it says that, you know, recited on the eve of 15 Shaban and Thursday nights for protection of yourself from the enemies, for the increase of your sustenance, risk and rosy, and for forgiveness of your sins. I was not able to find a single statement from the imams which says that you recite Dua Kumail on the 48th day of the marhum or the marhuma. Remember, this is a dua that you are reciting for yourself. You're talking about protection from the enemies. You're talking about the risk and sustenance in this dunya while you are alive. And forgiveness for your own sins. Then you look at the issue of dua mashlul, the second in the list. This is actually a dua about a young person who was very distressful situation because of his sin and his misdeed, especially being disrespectful towards his father and parents. And he went through distress because of that. And this is where he was, you know, this dua was given. So this is for a person who is dealing with the sins in this dunya and is specific for that. So it's a good dua, but for a specific purpose. Then you have dua adila. Dua Adila also is a very important dua. This is there also in dua in Mafatihul Janan. Most of these things are there. Dua Adila is to protect oneself from deviation from Sirat-e Mustaqim during the last moments of your life, just before you die, because Shaitan even will come and try to create doubts about your deen and iman even at that last moment. This dua adila will protect you from that doubts created by shaitan during the last moments of your life. So this is a dua adila, is a dua for a person to recite while he is alive. Or it should be recited to the for the person who is going through the last moments of death. For example, he is not able to recite because of his illness or whatever. Then somebody would read it to him at that time. It is not something to do to be done after death or on the chalisma or, you know, 40th of the deceased. So it's a good dua, but understand the purpose of it. Then we have in the list dua tawbah. Dua tawbah is a dua from a sahifa sajadiya of Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam. It's a long dua and it's a very powerful dua. But remember, this is a dua for the tawbah of the sins that we would have committed, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive. There is no indication that recite this dua for the on the 40th of a deceased person. Similarly, then we come to, you know, Hadith-e-Kisah once. Hadith-e-Kisah, there's no problem with Hadith-e-Kisah or the content or the story. It's a good story. But there is no indication which says that this should be recited on the 48th day of passing away of the marhum or marhuma. Tasbihat arba. Subhanallah walhamdulillah wa la ilaha illallah wallahu akbar. This is a very powerful tasbih. This is one of the what is known as at-taqibat al-amma, the general you know recitation that you do after the namaz, after any namaz. And the only and the narrations only talk about reciting it 30 times after the namaz. Go and look at Mafatihul Janan, you will see there. But there is nothing which says that you have to do it 41 times on the chalismo or the 40th of the marhum or the marhuma. Similarly, you know, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah rabbi wa atubu ilayh, you are doing istighfar for yourself. The word astaghfiru, oh Allah, I seek forgiveness for my sins. 41 times, okay, you do it 4,100 times, doesn't matter. But is there anything, any indication from the imams about it that you recite this on the 40th day? No. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُصْطَرُ. You know, when we talk about this issue of this dua, especially when we talk about a person who is in mariz or in difficulty or istirar, it's a powerful dua from the Quran. Again, it says, recite that 41 times. This is basically, it's about yourself. Reciting salawat 41 times. Salawat is a very good, you know, dua, a zikr. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim 41 times. I have not been able to see in the books of ahadith, as well as the software of the Shia, you know, collection of all the ahadith. We have actually a program where you can search all this. There is not a single hadith that I was able to find from any of the imams that they say that this astighfar and amma yujibul mustar and salawat and bismillah is to be recited on the 40th day of the passing of a marhum or a marhuma 41 times. I actually was intrigued by this number 41. Where does it come from? And so I looked again for even search by the number 41. I didn't find anything in the software. Then I actually opened the book of Sheikh Saduq, known as Al-Khisal. He has many, many books of hadith. Al-Khisal is a very interesting book of hadith where Sheikh Saduq has compiled the hadith according to numbers. For example, section one deals with most of the hadith that he was able to find. Well, Allah talks about one. It could be any theme or subject. Then section two deals with number two. Any hadith which talks about two items. Then three, four, five, all the way to 48. And then this section goes on 40 and plus. So in that section on 40th, I looked at it to see if there is any indication in the ahadith where any of the imam would have said that recite this on the 40th day of the marhum or the marhuma. No, I didn't see it. Moreover, the most commonly used book among the Shias, especially if you come from subcontinent, you know, you have Mafatihul Jinan or you have Tuhfatul Awam. And in none of these books, these rituals are mentioned in that way associated to the 40th day of the marhum or marhuma. And so my point is that, you know, it is cumbersome to recite all this. And especially the list, which is even longer than that when it comes to the number of surahs. And when it becomes a common practice, you would say, you know, what is the problem? Why can't just, you know, there's nothing wrong in it. I'm not saying anything, there is a guna in doing that. What I'm saying is that when it becomes a common practice, then everyone starts looking at one another. And when somebody's family has a, you know, wafat or, you know, demise of somebody, and if they are not able to do it, number one, they feel guilty. They think that they have not fulfilled their duty towards the marhum of their family. And mashallah, you know, there are many who would say, ah, oh, you're not doing this. You know, you don't respect your marhum. This is where we have to realize we are putting unnecessary burden on the families of the deceased. If you want to do it yourself, that's fine. You sit down. But don't make it a ritual and a common practice, which becomes then an unnecessary burden on other families. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not impose any obligation on a person more than their ability. And so this is something we have to keep in our mind, inshallah. Salawat. You know, sometimes I get the reaction to this. You say, Maulana, you know, there are mu'mineen and mu'minat on a higher level. You're only talking about the basic level. Well, mashallah, you might be on a higher level of iman. You know, yes, iman has 10 stages. But the point is, you to realize, you know, when you make something as a common practice, which is no base in the teachings of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, then you are creating a pressure on those who are, let's say, over a lower level. Let me narrate to you a story, a long hadith, but I'll just, you know, summarize it, where one of the servants of the Imam assigned a task, and then he comes back to the Imam. There is a conversation going on, and he talks about other people who are also Shias, but he made a kind of a negative remark about them. And at the end, Imam says, listen, you know, people have different levels of iman. One person has just one share, or he's on the first, you know, level. Second is on a second, other is a second level, then third level, then fourth, then the fifth, then sixth, then seventh. And Imam actually uses all of these numbers. And then he says, فَلَيْسَ يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُحْمَلَ صَاحِبُ السَّهَمْ عَلَى مَا عَلَيْهِ صَاحِبُ السَّهَمَيْنِ. You know, when a person is on the first level, it is not right to impose him what is there for the second level person. Because the more your level goes up, of course, your duties will increase. But this is on a personal level. Don't make it, a common practice. And then Imam actually uses an example. He says, you know, فَعَضُرِبُوا لَكَ مَثَلًا. I'll give you an example. He says there was a person, a Muslim person, who had a Christian neighbor. فَدَعَاهُ إِلَى الْإِسْلَامِ وَزَيِّنَ لَهُ فَعَجَابَهُ. He says, the Muslim basically talked to him about the Islamic faith and convinced him that Islam is a very beautiful religion. And this Christian fellow becomes Muslim. And so next day, when he became Muslim, early in the morning, even before dawn, he came to his door and he knocked. And this fellow said, Man hadha, who is this? He says, I'm your neighbor, so and so. So he says, what do you want at this time? He says, get up, do wuzu, put on your clothes, and come with me to the masjid. So the fellow, you know, this new convert, did wuzu, put on his clothes, went down with him to the to the masjid, and then, you know, until they did the Fajr prayers, and then he told him to sit down, do the, you know, du'as and tasbih. And when this Christian wanted to then get up, he says, you know, okay, it's done, let me go home. He said, well, you know, probably this was the winter season. He says, you know, the days are short, so why you want to go? You know, just stay here. It's just a few hours until, you know, Zuhr happens. Do your you know, recitations. So the fellow, poor fellow, sat down with him until Zuhr came. And after Zuhr, he wanted to get up. He said, well, you know, Asr will happen just soon. It's a short day, winter time. So this fellow sat down. He did Asr. Then he says, well, you know, it's sunset is going to happen. So he's... And this happened till Isha time. Then he actually went home. Next morning, when this fellow came and knocked on his door, he says, who is it? He says, I'm your neighbor. You know, get up, do wuzu. This is where the new convert says to him, أطلب لهذا الدين من هو أفرغ مني. Please go and find somebody who is idle, doesn't have anything to do. Ana insanun miskinun wa alayya ayal. I am a poor fellow and I have a family to feed. You know, I do work. And this is where Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq alayhi salam says, adkhaluhu fi shay'in wa akhrajuhu minhu. You know, this Muslim fellow admitted him into Islam and then made him leave Islam because of his attitude. And this is where we have to realize, you know, we cannot impose things on people, you know, and make it a common practice that people start feeling guilty about it if they don't do it. And so always go back to the seerah of the Ahlul Bayt. جب ہم لوگ تاریخ کو دیکھتے ہیں, یہ جو ہم نے شروع میں کہا تھا کہ جہاں تک تسلیت دینے کا طریقہ ہے, پینگ کنڈولنس کی بات ہے, یہ جو ہمارا رویہ صاحب مصیبت کے ساتھ کیا ہونا چاہیے, وہ فیملی جس میں موت واقع ہوئی ہے, اس میں ہم نے کہا تھا کہ سنت نبوی ہے کہ رسول اسلام نے جناب فاطمہ کو اسما بنت امیس کے گھر بھیجا تھا, جناب جعفر طیار کی زوجہ کے گھر, کہ 3 دن تک جا کے وہاں ان کو کھانا دینا, اور یہ سنت بن گئی, فجرت السنہ, اور یہ جو ہے ایک طریقہ بن گیا کہ جہاں جہاں موت واقع ہوتی ہے رشتہ دار یا جاننے والے جو ہیں وہ 3 دن وہاں کھانا پہنچاتے ہیں. اسی واقعے کی ایک تفسیری روایت بھی ہے جو ہم یہاں مصائب کے طور پہ بیان کرنا چاہ رہے ہیں تاکہ اس کوشچن آنسر میں زیادہ وقت مل سکے, کہ جب یہ جناب جعفر طیار کی شہادت ہوئی تھی جنگ تبوک میں, وچ از آن دی سیرین سائڈ, یہ بارڈر تھا اس زمانے میں ایسٹرن رومن امپائر اور عربین پیننزولا کا اس وقت, اور اس میں جناب رسول اسلام نہیں گئے تھے, مدینہ میں تھے. جب خبر ملی جعفر طیار کی شہادت کی تو رسول اسلام کھڑے ہوئے, بہرحال وہ کزن بھی تھے اور احترام بھی کرتے تھے, جعفر واز دا لیڈر آف دس گروپ ہو مائگریٹڈ فرام مکہ ٹو ابیسینیا ایتھوپیا. تو رسول اللہ جاتے ہیں اسما بنت امیس کے گھر, ابھی جناب اس اسما کو معلوم نہیں ہوا تھا کہ جعفر کی شہادت واقع ہوئی ہے. رسول اللہ ان کے گھر جاتے ہیں, کہتے ہیں تمہارے بچے کہاں ہیں؟ تو جناب اسما جو ہیں تینوں بیٹوں کو بلاتی ہیں, عبداللہ, عون اور محمد, یہ جناب جعفر کے 3 بیٹے تھے. عبداللہ بن جعفر وہی ہیں جن کی شادی بعد میں ہوئی ہے جناب زینب سے, اور ان کے بیٹوں کا بھی نام عون و محمد تھا. تو یہ 3 بچے تھے جعفر طیار کے جناب اسما بنت امیس سے, عبداللہ و عون و محمد. رسول اللہ نے ان کو قریب بلایا اور ان کے سروں پر ہاتھ پھیرا. اس منظر کو دیکھ کے جناب اسما بنت امیس نے کہا, انک تمسح رؤوسهم کانہم ایتام. اے اسما بنت امیس رسول اللہ سے کہتی ہیں, اے رسول اللہ, آپ تو اس طرح سے ان کے سر پر ہاتھ پھیر رہے ہیں جس طرح لگتا ہے کہ یہ یتیم ہو چکے ہیں. تو اس وقت رسول اسلام نے کہا کہ ہاں اسما, تمہارے شوہر کی شہادت واقع ہوئی ہے, اور وہ رونا شروع کر دیتی ہیں. رسول اسلام نے جناب اسما کی تسلی کے لیے کہا کہ خداوند عالم نے ان کا ایک مخصوص درجہ رکھا ہے, 2 پر دیے ہیں, وہ جنت میں وہ سیر کر رہے ہیں. تو اسما کہتی ہیں کہ رسول اللہ, یہ جو فضیلت آپ میرے شوہر کے بیان کی ہے آپ نے, میری خواہش ہے کہ آپ منبر پر بیان کریں تاکہ سب کو معلوم ہو جائے. یہ طریقہ ہے جہاں تک گھر والوں کو تسلی دینے کا ہے. 3 دن تک پھر وہاں جناب فاطمہ جو ہیں کھانا لے کے جاتی ہیں, رشتہ دار تھے یہ, بہت قریبی دوست بھی تھی اسما بنت امیس جناب فاطمہ کی. آخری شخص جن کی گفتگو ہوئی ہے جناب فاطمہ سے وہ اسما بنت امیس ہی تھی. اور یہی رویہ آپ دیکھیں گے کہ ہمارے یہاں یہ طریقہ مذہبی طریقہ بن گیا ہے, یہ سنت نبوی ہے, اور یہ سیرت اہل بیت بھی ہے. امام حسین علیہ السلام کا قافلہ جب کوفہ کی طرف جا رہا تھا, ایک منزل تھی کہ جہاں قافلہ رکا اور کچھ لوگ کوفے سے آئے, اور ان سے امام حسین علیہ السلام کو یہ خبر ملی کہ مسلم بن عقیل کی شہادت واقع ہو گئی ہے. اس وقت امام حسین علیہ السلام نے مسلم بن عقیل کی بیٹی کو بلوایا, رقیہ نام تھا غالباً, اور اس کو اپنے گود پہ بٹھایا اور اس کے سر پر جو ہے ہاتھ پھیرنا شروع کر دیتی ہیں. جناب مسلم بن عقیل کی زوجہ نے جب یہ دیکھا ہے تو کہا کہ مولا, آپ وہ برتاؤ کرتے ہیں جو یتیموں کے ساتھ کیا جاتا ہے. اس وقت یہی کہا ہے, بچی نے بھی یہی جملہ کہا ہے, جس پر امام کہتے ہیں ہاں تمہارے بابا کی شہادت ہو چکی ہے, لیکن مجھے اب اپنا باپ سمجھنا یہ ماموں تھے. بہرحال ہم امام حسین علیہ السلام سے صرف اتنا جملہ کہیں گے کہ مولا جب آپ نے مسلم بن عقیل کے یتیم بچی کو اپنے گود میں لیا ہے, اس کے اوپر شفقت کا ہاتھ پھیرا ہے, گلہ گلے سے ملایا ہے, ایک طرف دیکھنے کی سکینہ اس منظر کو نہ دیکھ رہی ہو, اس لیے کہ کربلا میں جب سکینہ یتیمہ ہوگی تو وہاں کوئی تسلی دینے والا نہیں ہوگا, بلکہ شمر ملعون آ کے سکینہ کو تماچا مارتا رہے. لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين سيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. خداوند اس قليل عبادت قبول فرما, ہمارے گناہ کو بخش دے, ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما. خداوندہ جن مرحومین کے لیے یہ ایصال ثواب کی مجلس ہیں, ذکر قرآن اور اہل بیت ہوا ہے, خداوندہ اس ذکر جمیل کا ثواب ان کی روح کو پہنچا دے, ان کے گناہوں کو معاف فرما, ان کے درجات کو بلند فرما, ان کے گھر والوں کو توفیق جمیل عنایت فرما. خداوندہ جہاں جہاں انسان ہیں خداوندہ ان کو کرونا وائرس کی اس مصیبت سے جلد نجات دے. شیعان علی کو خصوصاً اپنے حفاظت میں رکھ, امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما. ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم.
Inshallah, tonight we will have a live question and answer session with Maulana Syed Muhammad Rizvi. For those who would like to ask questions, we will be using Menti. The website is menti.com and please use the code 2779118. That's code 2779118. So inshallah, I will start with the first question. Is it makruh for women to attend burials at the cemetery, or is that just a cultural custom?
Interestingly, I was just looking at the rituals about it. This is part of the. I think there was even a hadith that I just looked at it yesterday. On this issue, so this is a religious cultural combination, yes, that women should avoid going in the actual burial. Not that they are not allowed to go to the qabristan, to the cemetery, the issue is that at the time of the funeral, yes.
Mm-hmm. Another question came in saying, do you like doing Zoom lectures? Is it harder or easy for yourself?
Well, it's not easy because I'm not able to see people, so I don't know where they are following, what is the reaction of the people, are they happy, they are angry with me or whatever, you know. So to have a live audience is, of course, that is the ideal situation, but we still thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the technology that we are still able to communicate and, you know, virtually be in the programs, yes.
Is it permissible to avoid people who hurt us, but they are our close relatives?
Is it permissible to do what?
To avoid people who hurt us, but they are our close relatives.
Well, avoiding in a sense that, you know, whenever you meet them, they are going to taunt you or insult you, that's not a problem. You should avoid them. But you should not totally cut off your relationship with them. Mm-hmm. At least the minimum requirement for what is known as silat ar-rahm, you know, maintaining the ties with the relatives, is to say salam. Mm-hmm. You know, or once in a while, call them up to say, how are you doing? But even if they, in response to that also, if they just abuse you, then of course your duty is over. You know, but it should be they who do that and not you. You shouldn't cut up the ties. Yeah.
We have a question coming regarding the diagram that was sent out regarding the congregation prayer. So there's a question saying, we saw the diagram on how to pray congregation with social distancing. If someone prays congregation without observing social distancing rules, knowingly or unknowingly, is that prayer valid?
Well, the prayer is, if they do the Jamaat prayers with the normal way, for example, without, and so in that process they are violating the local health regulations about social distancing, the namaz would be okay. But then they are doing something where if a person then, you know, is infected by that individual, then he or she would be responsible for it in the eyes of God.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So the namaz would still be okay. But what that person is doing, as far as violating the social distancing,
mm-hmm.
that would not be a right thing to do.
Okay.
It's just like somebody, you know, sometimes I get this question. Somebody came to the masjid at the last moment, is Juma time, and they park somewhere illegally,
mm-hmm.
rush in to join the namaz.
Mm.
So somebody will say, Maulana, why don't you announce that their namaz is batil? No, their namaz is not batil. Their namaz is still valid,
mm.
but their action of parking illegally is wrong and sinful.
It's against the law, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's a question about the vaccine. Should we take vaccines recommended by Western governments even when we can stay safe and social distance by staying at home?
Well, you know, by itself, it's not something forbidden to use the vaccine,
mm-hmm.
Unless you come to know there are very, you know, serious side effects, which we wouldn't know until after a few years,
mm-hmm.
because it's something new. Or if you look at the ingredients of it, how it is made, we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, using the vaccine by itself, even if it's from Western companies, there's no problem in it. Especially if it's going to make your life normal as far as interaction with people is concerned.
Mm-hmm.
There are all conspiracy theory out there. For example, there was some Maulana on a, you know, YouTube now, everybody comes up with all statements they make, that when this issue was emphasized about using hand sanitizers,
mm-hmm.
so this fellow sat down there, made a statement that, oh, you know, this is a Western conspiracy. When you do that, you know, your ability to produce children will go down. They want the Muslim numbers to go down. Well, I think, you know, the most usage of hand sanitizers in the West is in the Western countries.
Yeah.
You know, there's no truth to this whole, you know, stories and conspiracy theories that people just make up. Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. So a question has come in saying, if I have backbited about someone in the past and they are non-Muslim, and it is okay to ask them for forgiveness, is there a way around this that does not include going up to that person?
No, in that case, you know, just do istighfar overall for the sins. That should be okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And just to remind everyone, the Minty code is 2779118 for the questions to come in. The question has come in. The question came in, before Allah made this world, what was He doing before? What gave Him the knowledge to create us in the universe? There's another part of the question, so maybe we'll do it in section.
Okay.
So before Allah had made this world, what was He doing before?
Well, I think we came at the end of the process.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The dunya was created before us because it is for us.
Mm-hmm.
The malaika were created before us. The jinn were created before us.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, specifically, what was Allah doing at that time? Of course, you know, all these things were there already before He created us.
Just waiting for some more questions to come in. So there's a question come in regarding after the mayat. Can you comment about the practice of inserting the fingers into the soil of the grave and reciting some surahs?
So after the burial?
That's good.
Yeah, it's recommended actually to put your fingers, of course, just the tip of it, a little bit. Not you don't have to dig it out, dig in there, no. And recite Surah Inna Anzalna 7 times in, you know, you move from one spot, you move the hand from one to another. And basically, it is part of this overall theme where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks for excuse to forgive an individual. And one of them is this, you know, wherever the mu'mineen have, you know, touched the ground, the soil, and recited in anzallah, all those areas would be prevented from azab on that mayyit. Or for example, as long as the water is wet, you know, we pour water on the grave, you know, as long as the soil is wet, the azab will be removed. Similarly, when we talk about jaridatain, you know, there is a recommendation that you put two green branches of a tree under the arms of the mayyit in the coffin. And as long as they are green, you know, the azab would be averted. And so they are all different. So these are just excuses that Allah says, I'll forgive you. Do this, do this, do this.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, when we do the namaz-e-janazah, the fourth zikr between the fourth and fifth takbir, where we say, Allahumma inna la na'lamu minhu illa khayra. That, oh Allah, we don't know about this mayyit anything but good. Even though we know him. Maybe he was our fellow, our friend. We know he's good and he's bad, but still we testify there. Mm-hmm. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, well, if this mu'mineen can conceal the weaknesses of one another, then I am Sattar al-Uyub. You know, one of my titles is that I cover up the weaknesses of people. I don't expose them.
Mm-hmm.
So if they are doing this with their own fellow, I will also forgive his sins. So these are all ways by which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like to, you know, shower his forgiveness.
So just a reminder for the members and the community members that we have been receiving a lot of questions regarding Qums, and there will be a seminar on December 22nd with Jafri Tabligh Committee and Maulana Syed Muhammad Rizvi. That's again on Tuesday, December 22nd. So do stay tuned for that poster to come. There's a question about namaz. Is it better to pray Zuhr and Asr and Maghrib and Isha together, or is it better to separate them?
So the norm during the days of the Prophet was that there was a gap between Zuhr and Asr and between Maghrib and Isha. But the Prophet also, sometimes, without any excuse, it was not a rainy day, he was not traveling, it wasn't that he was sick on that day. I mean, these are the cases where even Sunnis say that you can combine Zuhr and Asr and Maghrib and Isha. So he even did this without any excuse. And he was actually asked, according to Abdullah ibn Abbas, he says, you know, the Prophet was asked, why did you do it? There was no reason for combining. And this is where the Prophet says, so there is no haraj, there is no inconvenience on my ummah. And so the Prophet says that I even combined it just for the sake of convenience. So whether you do it separately or you do it together, both are the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even if we do it for the sake of convenience. Now, according to the study of Ayatollah Khoi, rahmatullah alayh, he used to say that this gap is actually there for nafila prayers. And once you do the nafila prayer, the gap is there already. So you already separated Zuhr from, Asr from Zuhr and Isha from Maghrib by reciting nafila in between. And so he says that the gap is not for its own sake. The gap is there for nafila prayers. So if you are not doing nafila prayers, then it is actually afdal to recite the next namaz soon after the first one.
Thank you. The question about deceased soul. Does the deceased soul visit the house for 40 days after the death?
No, there is no truth to the statement that the soul visits the home for 40 days or stays in the home until you do this amal on the 40th day. Only then he is gone. No, it's not something like that. Mm-hmm. Yes, we have a hadith that mu'mineen, depending on their levels, the soul of the mu'mineen would have the permission to go and visit the houses of their family. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His grace, will only show them the positive things. Because he doesn't want the soul of the marhumeen to be, of the mu'mineen to be distressed. And so, yes, for example, on Fridays we are told that the soul of the marhumeen would come to the family, to the house, and they will actually be longing to see whether you are sending them a gift or not, of a Surah Fatiha or a Sadaqah in their name. You know, a simple charity, and when that happens, they are very happy. And if they go, they feel very, lonely on that day. So yes, there is a concept, but nothing to do with the 40 days till death. Mm-hmm. It's actually depending on the level of the marhum or the marhuma, the frequency would be there at least for once a week on Fridays. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Question has come in. Please elaborate on qaza timing for Maghrib and Isha. Can they be prayed with adhan niyat until Fajr time and after midnight or midpoint between the day and the night?
When it comes to the Maghrib time ends with the midnight, middle of the night. And so that's where, if you do it after that, you had to do the niyat of qaza. But Isha namaz, no. If you have delayed Isha namaz for whatever reason, you missed out or whatever, then you still have just before the Fajr time to do that. And so between midnight and Fajr, you will recite Isha without saying Ada or Qaza. You will not say Qaza for it. You will just say Qurbatan Lillah. Wajib Qurbatan Lillah.
The message comes that can we get an update on the Quran translation, which I assume Maulana yourself has done?
Yeah, alhamdulillah, the main point was typesetting it. Mm-hmm. Where you have the Arabic and the English, and that was the technically a challenge. The work has already reached to about 22 paras or juz. Mm-hmm. So now we are towards the end of inshallah. Okay. The way I say, we already crossed the top of the mountain. Now we're going down.
Inshallah. The question has come through. Did Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, have a belly button considering he was not born from a mother?
I don't know about it. never thought about it. Mm-hmm. Nothing crossed my readings about it. Mm-hmm. And it has no implication on our aqidah anyway. So,
question has come regarding ghusl. So when performing a ghusl, Does one have to ensure all the hair on the head receives water, or is it enough for the water to reach skin only, so scalp, especially when long hair?
In ghusl, the scalp, the skin, the water should reach there. And let's say to the roots of the hair. But the rest part of the hair, no. So especially for ladies, when they have long hair, in ghusl, it is not required that the entire length of the hair should become wet. The scalp as well as the root of the hair should become wet, that's all.
Again, just to remind members that we are accepting questions from menti.com and the code is 2779118. Question has come regarding cooking. So are we permitted to use sausages with red rice wine as an ingredient when cooking, and what is acceptable level, what is the acceptable level of ingredient?
Okay, let me just double check here because I don't remember all these ingredients. But we had a seminar on food, halal and haram. It should be in there. I'll just look at, take a quick look. You can go on to the next question.
Okay. We'll just wait for the question to come through. I'm just waiting for the question to come through.
Okay.
There's a question regarding elections. So would it have been haram to vote in the US election? The mainstream candidates are both pro-Israel, and in one majlis, Zakir described them to be like the Yazid or Muawiyah.
Well, you see, the situation in US or Canada or most of the European countries, we had to realize that if you go in isolation and don't participate, what will be the consequences? You don't necessarily have a choice between right and wrong. You know, none of these parties are absolutely right from the Islamic point of view, no. And in that case of scenario, you had to pick and choose what is lesser of the two evils. As I said many times, when we do this voting, we are not expecting that our path will be, you know, made of roses. But at least we can choose whether the thorns will be less or not. So there will be problems, whether it's one party or another, whether it's Republican or Democrats. But we can decrease the level of suffering for ourselves and the Ummah. You know, and if we can do that gradually, maybe a time will come, we'll have more, you know, influence. So isolation is not the answer. Yeah.
Okay. A question has come in, are animals going to be resurrected? And are they accountable for their actions? If so, on what criteria? And if not, what is the wisdom behind their suffering?
Yeah, well, it's a good question. And Allama Tabatabai actually talks about this. He says, animals also are kind of, they have their own societies. He has a long discussion, I don't remember which volume of Al-Mizan has that. Means even the translation is already there in English of that volume. Inshallah, if the person is asking the question, send me the question in the email. I'll give him the reference and they can read that in details there. I don't remember the entire discussion, but the possibility is there. Because there is an ayat in Quran which says, that on the day when Hushirat, when the animals would be resurrected. So there is a concept of the day when al-wuhush, the wild animals will be, Hushirat means they will be resurrected and gathered together. So So there is a concept there, but probably it's, I don't think you will see the animals same as we see here in this dunya. In the Jannah, no. Maybe they have their own separate dunya.
So another question has come in through, what are some practical steps we can take in our daily lives to be aware of our death in the Day of Judgment?
Zikr of maut is a, means remembering death is a very powerful tool to keep us on the right path. But just remember that it shouldn't reach to the point that you get into depression and you get kind of distressed with this life. No. And maintain that balance that it is this life that you have to use for your akhirah. But problem happens when people forget the death and they think, you know, oh, this is the only life I have, so let me do whatever I can, right or wrong. Mm-hmm. And I think the best way to remember the death is actually in namaz. Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib has really given us a very powerful insight of this, something we do every day. He says, when you do the sajda, I'm just summarizing it for the sake of, you know, giving time to others. He says, when you go into sajda, you put your forehead on the turbat, on the earth. Mm-hmm. This is a reminder that this is your origin. Adam, we are all from Adam. Adam was created from the clay. When you get up from the sajda, this is your birth. He says, when you go back into it, this is the symbol of your death. You will be buried in there. Mm-hmm. And when you come out from the second sajda, this is the symbol of your resurrection, mm-hmm. the day of Qiyamah. Mm-hmm. And so Amir al-Mu'mineen says, this whole process of sajda, we have Qiyam 1, Ruku 1, many things. Tashahud is only one. But sajda, everywhere we do, one after another. And when he was asked, this is the symbolism behind it. So if we keep that in mind, this will be a good reminder. And as I, you know, whenever I read this hadith, I always, things come to mind and I say, you know, Ali said that when you get up from the first sajda, this is your birth. When you go down into the second sajda, this is your death. What do you do in between? Mm-hmm. What do you recite? Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa atubu ilay. So there are two things there. The life of this dunya is so short. How many seconds? Mm-hmm. And what are you supposed to do? You are supposed to do whatever you can mm-hmm. and ask forgiveness for your weaknesses. Mm-hmm. And so use the namaz. You don't necessarily need anything else to remember that. Use the what you do in the namaz.
It's an eye-opener to actually see that.
Yes.
We actually do it daily, but we don't realize it.
Yeah. Means we do it every day, but many people don't even realize that this is the symbolism on it.
Another question is coming regarding ziyarat. So how reliable are the recommended ziyarats for each day? For example, on Saturday, to recite the ziyarat of Prophet Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Those are ziyarat which are there for the days of the week. I have not personally looked into it myself, but I wouldn't have a problem in relying on Sheikh Abbas Qummi. He was a very prominent muhaddis. And looking at the content of ziyarat, I don't see any problem. I would have no hesitation in saying that these are authentic.
Just to remind members, I think we'll go for another 10 minutes. The code for Minty is 2779118. And you can ask various questions to Minty. Question came in through, can women on their monthly cycle visit the graveyard?
Yeah, there is no prohibition as such. The karahat, there is no hurmat about this whole issue. It is makruh when to be in the same room with the mayyit. But that is only a karahat there, it's not haram. But going to the grave site, no, there's no issue there.
The question about the rice wine came back up. Okay.
Still, I haven't been able to look for it. Let me see.
Yeah, I'll give you a couple of minutes. Some more questions are coming through. I can ask you this question while you're looking. So how much is the marhum benefiting from the madrasas and the niyaz and these days the countless Zoom madrasas? Isn't it better to instead put it towards the jariya causes?
You see, when it comes to the issue of madras, you see, Majlis is basically zikr of Quran and the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt.
Mm-hmm. Oh. I think you froze there, man.
Let me.
Just remind members again that the mentee code is 2779118, and Maulana will be rejoining. Okay, I think there was just a technical issue. Also, to remind members that we will have the Qum seminar, inshallah, on December 22nd, again on Tuesday, December 22nd. A Qum seminar by Jafi Tabligh Committee and our resident alim Maulana Syed Muhammad Rizvi. I think Maulana is back. I think you're muted at the moment, Maulana.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay. So when we talk about the sawab for the marhumeen, when majlis is what? Majlis is basically, we talk about Quran, hadith, history of the Ahlul Bayt. And so whatever we do at the time, you know, this is some good work. And and the sawab of that zikr of Quran and Ahlul Bayt or even reciting Surah Yasin goes to the marhum. So that is an element of sawab there. And it also actually is kind of a opportunity to for the family to basically get the condolence and things like that. It is an opportunity for the family actually to give the condolence. And also, so it has a social aspect also. If you want to do something just for sawab, then yes, you can do what we call sadaqah on a regular basis or even do sadaqah jariyah, you know, do perpetual charity. Means doing something which will continue for a long time. And so as long as, for example, if you dedicate some money for, let's say, digging the water well for the poor people in third world countries, for example, as long as that water is there and people are using it, the sawab will continue. This is what called sadaqah jariyah, perpetual, sadaqah. Or education-wise, you know. Sometimes you just give simple sadaqah once and it's gone. So that's a simple sadaqah. What's jariya means doing something where the benefit of that will continue later on. Yeah.
Okay. Question has come in. Can you please explain the difference between namaz washad and namaz fardhi amir?
Namaz washad is something which is to be only recited on the night when the deceased is buried. And the way it has been explained, basically, the Prophet says that it is a difficult night for the people who die. And so give sadaqah for them. And if you cannot give sadaqah, then do namaze wahshat. Now, whether it's for one person or the whole community does it, there is a controversy about it. From what I understand, this is not a communal thing to do. So that's only for one night. And for one individual, you can't do it for multiple people in one namaz. But when it comes to namaz-e hadiye mayyit, that you can say it whenever you want, as many times as you want, for as many marhumeen as you want in one namaz. So that is the difference there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The question here comes through. What advice do you have to safeguard our youth from the liberal agendas, especially in relation to feminism and LGBTQ movements, as they are quite big and appealing the fact, but by Muslims we are a small minority.
I think it is important to talk about these issues. There was a time we did not talk about it, mm-hmm. but we had to realize this is an issue. There is a challenge out there. Which is right there in front of us. Even if we want to avoid it, it will come up. Mm-hmm. It will come up in front of our children at the school level, even in the curriculum here in Ontario. They talk about it. And so I think this conversation has to be increased on the level of the madrasa and even, on the level of the general discourses in the programs. The parents also need to be more aware about it. And the point is, here in the Western world, we will not impose our views on others. If this is the lifestyle they want to live, it's their choice. We will not do anything as far as their lifestyle is concerned. We will not impose our views or values on them. But nor do we accept for them to impose their values on us. They cannot come and say that, we drink, this is a common practice. Wine is even part of the religious ceremony in the churches, for example. Mm-hmm. So you should consider this to be okay. No, for us it is haram. But we are not going to go and stop you from it or campaign against it, no. But don't impose that on us. So similarly, this is your lifestyle you chose. Islam doesn't agree with it. And so that is something which has to be made very clear about it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. My question has come through. What are your thoughts about those people who are anti-maskers and feel that we shouldn't need to social distance because it takes away their freedom or right, especially when people are in our community?
Again, they are against what?
Against, they are anti-maskers and they are against social distancing. They feel that it shouldn't be, because it takes away their freedom or rights.
Yeah, well, the it is a common sense issue. If the experts are saying that in order to keep yourself safe and others safe, it's not only you. By social distancing, you are also keeping others safe. If you want to get into harm, that's your problem. Mm-hmm. But the issue is, are you allowed to harm others? No. And this is where our marajas say very clearly, all of them, that if the medical professionals are giving you this guideline, that you have to maintain the social distance, then you have to adhere to that. Mm-hmm. Because they are the experts in that field.
So I'll give you a couple of minutes to look at that rice wine question. I'll just remind the members about the upcoming seminar that we have.
Okay.
Inshallah, on Tuesday, December 15th, we will have a seminar by Jaffi Tabli Committee and Jaffi Funerals Committee. The topic being death, ghusl, and kafan. So we led by our resident alim and followed by a live question and answer. Also on next Jumarat, we will have on December 17th, starting at 7 p.m., we will have a Jumarat program, followed by after the lecture by Sheikh Jaffer, we will have a mental health seminar by JSS, which will be led by Sister Marzia Hassan. And also we will have the blockbuster seminar that will be coming up on December 27th at 7:30. So do register, and the deadline is on December 20th. And also finally, the Qum seminar, which will be held on December 22nd. The seminar will be by Jafi Tabli Committee and our resident alim, Maulana Syed, Rizvi. So inshallah, any further questions for Qum will be able to be answered in that seminar.
I can't find the answer at the moment, so inshallah, we'll leave it for some other time.
Inshallah. No problem. So the question, we'll just do a couple more because it is 8:50 and the time is still going. So sometimes it is difficult to find a balance encouraging your children to do good and at the same time not making them feel forced. So how do we find the balance?
Number one, this is a process which has to start from childhood. You can't, you know, all of a sudden open your eyes when they are in their teenager, you know, phase. And the best thing would be you become the role model and example, and don't push them to the extent that they become rebellious or they start feeling, you know, Islam to be a burden to an extent that they start hating the Islamic teachings. So you had to keep that balance there, you know.
Okay, so inshallah, we go to our final question. When is the human soul created? We know that the soul at death is extracted by the angel of death. What method does the soul enter the body?
From the narration that we have, remember these things are not, you know, science can't really say much. This is beyond the realm of science. So we had to go to the Quran and the Hadith of the Masumeen. And what we see is that that the souls have been created from before. And it is at the time when a child is before the birth. You know, when we talk about fourth month of the pregnancy, that is where the soul comes in. And that's why from the legal point of view in Islam, you know, once the baby is 4 months old in the womb, the baby is considered to be a full person. Before that, no. And so the time where the soul comes in is at the fourth month of the pregnancy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So just like to thank you, Maulana, for taking your time out and having this live question and answer. Inshallah, we hope to have some more in the future. So inshallah, we'll conclude today's Jumarat program with Jayatul Waritha by Mahdi Hussein Dirani. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.